Hello everyone, thanks for coming. My name is Batuhan, I'm a high school student from Turkey. And in this talk, I'm going to show you a few tricks of how to hack CPython interpreter. Before we start, you can ask me any question through Twitter with that is identical handle, and get slides from speaker deck with that same handle. So we are here to hack the CPython, but what is hacking? When you say hack or hacking or hacker, people often think a black wearing guy who serves for evil forces, who works for money, tries to break into your server. Yes, they are hackers. But hacking is not just doing an illegal thing. Think about torrenting. When you say torrenting, people think you are doing something illegal, but you can torrent with someone's permission. So we are going to do a legal hacking of CPython. The definition of hacking is using something in a way you are not supposed to do. Like in Turkey, we use old cheese containers to plant. It's a recycling hack. And we are going to hack Python for our freedom. You all know this guy, Richard Stallman, who saved us from slaving to the bad guys. We all grateful to him. He hacks for his freedom, so do we. Anyone heard PEP313? No, it's an old PEP about adding Roman literals as Python integers. It is rejected with some good reasons in 2005. But what if you want to use PEP313? Isn't it your freedom? Yes, it is. It is why we are going to hack. For doing such hacks, we need to learn how CPython works. Every step in that execution model is a breakpoint to us where we can inject our code or alter the code output. For an example, if you want to implement PEP313, you need to replace all capital X with 10 in the AST2 compiling step. Okay. Okay. The first step is tokenizing. When you say Python file.py, Python will read your file in the encoding you have specified and then stream it to the tokenizer. Think about 2 plus 2. There are 3 tokens, identifiers. Like 2 is an integer, plus is an operator, 2 is an integer. And by the way, the first encoding is the first token is the encoding token. You may use it when you are hacking. But tokens doesn't know about relationship. It doesn't know if something it in the ifs body or ifs test. So we need something more relational, like concrete syntax trees. The parser of Python generates concrete syntax trees from the tokens that stream it into it. And this is the last step. You can convert bidirectional. Like you can convert a code into the CSD concrete syntax tree and concrete syntax tree into the CSD. The CSDs of two same expressions are different. Like you can write 2 plus 2 with 15 white spaces between the operator and integer or without white space. These two CSDs are different, but we need to know they are the same. So we need something more abstract, like abstract syntax tree. It is generated by ASDL from the 2.5, I think. And the ASD just keeps relevant information about compiling. Like it just keeps nodes, line information, and colon offset. ASD, we can hack AST by Python's app. Python says, don't hack the parser, don't hack the bytecode. If you want to hack, use it AST. It offers a great API for hacking AST. Like, this is 3 lines of code, adds A to beginning of every variable, like X plus 10, Y plus Z. When you transform the AST with this code, Python will understand it like AX plus AY plus AZ. And there is a great documentation about this AST on a site called the Green Tree Snakes. You can check that out. I think Python refers to it on DevGuide or the official documentation. And this is the last step of compiling, bytecode generation. Python uses a format called bytecode to store instructions. Python have a disassembler for these bytecode objects, but doesn't have an assembler. I proposed an assembler on Python IDEs last month, and it is rejected, like the people optimizer API. The people is the optimizer for the bytecode objects. It has only a few optimizations. And if you want to add new thing, you need to write your own people. We are going to do that too. And this is the last step of execution model evaluation. Python will go through every instruction you have specified in that bytecode with a for loop, also and a help of GCC feature called labeled GOTOs. And it will push and pop to the stack. See, Python virtual machine is stack-based. So it uses push and pop. When you say 2 plus 2, it means it will push 2 to the stack, 2 to the stack, and then an instruction called binary add come in and pop the last value, last two value from the stack and merge them into the each other and push it back, push the 4 back. Yes. So let's hack. The first hack of I'm going to tell is using valors operator on Python 3.7. It's added on Python 3.8, but you can use this on Python 3.7. For doing such a hack, we need to interfere between tokenization and reading file. The only step between tokenization and reading file is the encoding. So we are going to add our encoding. And when we are decoding, we will alter this code with Python 3.7 compatible code. Our study is we should run before the tokenization happen. We need a new tokenizer, or we can modify the Python's tokenized module, and we will tokenize the source with that module. We will alter this code and alter this code by changing tokens, changing positions of tokens, and then we are going to untokenize it and stream back to the real tokenizer. For modifying tokens, we need something called token module. I import that as tokens. When you add a new token to the CPython, you need to add an ID for it and a name for it. Our token names is canonical and ID is 255. I added the tokens to the token module and I added the token itself to the exact token types. It's a dictionary where tokenized module uses that to find the ID of n token. And for changing the tokenized mechanism, you should look at the source code of tokenized module. I looked and I saw there is a one main rule that used for tokenized module. So I am altering that with adding my cute valor operator. The second step is writing a decode function for our encoding valor 37. This decode function has an extra parameter beside the input and errors. It is encoding. It is for because you can specify your own encoding with values 37. For an example, you can say values 37 dash UTF-2, and it will decode the encoding you have specified. Also, it will alter the code. I'm just streaming it back to the generate values source code and return with the coding you encoding you have specified. And this is the last step, is adding a new encoding. We need a search function. Codex.register uses the search function. And if we return a codec info, codex.register allows us to register this codec info. I'm just streaming values 37 and dash, forcing if you have specified an encoding or not. If you don't specify, it will use UTF-8 and return a codec info. By the way, you need to register this encoding every time a Python session starts. For this, we need to hack the site module. Anyone heard site module? Site? No. We don't care about site module, actually. We care about its behavior. Site module uses pthash files, and we are going to inject our code at that pthash files. This is the code for implementing rejected PEPs like 313,
we are going to use Roman literals as Python integers. Our strategy is we are going to run when we are imported. We are going to only be effective inside of this allow scope, and we are going to raise proper error messages when it is used outside of this scope. For implementing this PEP, we need to use AST modules, not transformer. It goes through to every name definition like A, X, test, obtainer, and capital X, I, V, and checks for is it a Roman literal or not. If it is, it is going to return its integer representation by returning a new node. For scoping, we need an extra transformer that will go through to every with statement and checks the with statement name is allow, like this. If it is allow, it will get the first argument, and then it will get to the transformer we wrote with that argument, and transform only with body, not the whole file. It just transform only with body, and then it will copy the locations of nodes to the new node and fix missing line nodes and return the new with node. The runtime, we should run when we are imported, so we are going to call a function called allow with lowercase. This will import ourselves and get the file and read the file and parse file to AST. Then it will call our transformer, the transformer we wrote here, to the file, and then we are going to compile that transformed AST by manually and execute it under the modules namespace. Yeah. Another funny hack is Rust return. Rust returns implicitly, so do Python with that RLR decorator. We are going to return implicitly. We need two things: return the last statement, last expression, and we should allow infinite branching, like if else inside of a if else. We should return all possible last expressions. The first thing to transform AST is we need to go through to every function definition and check that if there is a RLR decorator. If there is, we need to remove that decorator. We don't want recursion. And then call the adjust method. The adjust method will find the last statement of a function, and then if it's an expression, it will pop that statement and return it as a AST.return. If it is a if statement, it will adjust the if's body with that same function. And this is how we support infinite branching. The another thing is an alternative to people optimizer, people optimizer. We are going to optimize eliminating local vars. Maybe you have heard, there was a blog post about it called CPython's bytecode compiler is dumb, and it doesn't optimize eliminating local variables. It doesn't make this optimization. And we are going to make it ourselves. Our strategy is when we are going to run when a function decorated, we just only make the optimizations user have specified. And we are going to re-put the source, the bytecode of a function back when it is done. For optimizing, we need a decorator. This decorator will create a bytecode object from function. The bytecode object comes from this module, and it is immutable. So we are going to return a new bytecode object every time we make an optimization. And then we will re-put the code of bytecode object at the end, and function will be optimized. I'm going to show an example of optimizations. This is eliminating local variables. We will go through to bytecode and find which symbol value is a constant and which symbol used where, and then keep a track of that and find the unused symbols to eliminate local variables. And then we are going to remove them manually by using a for loop, remove all the unnecessary symbols. You can't assemble bytecode in standard library modules, but you can use a module called bytecode from third as a third byte module from Victor Stinner. It has its own people implementation you can hack, and it assembles bytecode great. This is the last hack I'm going to do. Is this is Catalyzer V1 extended. Catalyzer is a module for hooking functions like audit hooks, but it's more general concepted. It will hook your functions. The first version of Catalyzer uses decorators to hook your functions, like before pre-hooks, on-call hooks, and post-hooks. But in that extended version, I didn't want to mutate the functions you gave to us. So I am using an methodology to hack the CPython's calling function instead of user's function. So this is the code for hooking the into a Py function Pascal keyboards. This function used when a bytecode comes to call a Python function. I'm using James Powell's code hooking lib hook for this, a slightly modified version called lpyhook. And this field overwrite the memory address of CPython function with my modified CPython function. And it is how we are going to inject our code into the CPython's evaluation step. For modifying the CPython function, I directly copied the code of it and then edit and then checked for Catalyzer sign. If a function used in Catalyzer, Catalyzer will sign it. If the function has a Catalyzer sign, I will call the Catalyzer when before the function call, on the function call, and after the function call. Yeah, this is it. Thank you for coming and listening. You can contact me through Twitter.
Okay.